Now let's discuss the evolution of land use and transportation systems in a bit more detail. I want to make four distinctions of how we can look at this. The first perspective I'd like to offer is that transportation is a response to land use, and look at this in terms of a suburban context. This is an idea that transportation capacity follows demand, that suburban expansion development of residential suburbs produces a demand for travel which is accommodated with transportation facilities. And this is the classic post-war engineering approach to serving the suburbs with highway capacity. The second version of this is transportation as a response to land use in an urban context. And this is when urban intensification produces demand for space-efficient travel. So situations in which the private auto simply cannot be accommodated in the space, and therefore leads to the development of heavy rail, light rail, bus rapid transit, and active transportation modes. Another way of looking at this is land use as a response to transportation in the suburban context. And this is land use follows the provision of transportation accessibility. In this case, we could say the development of the interstate highway system in the 1960s shaped land use by providing accessibility to areas that were previously not really feasible for residential development because it took too long to get this to the core of jobs in the center of the city. So this explains the development of residential suburbs as well as the suburbanization of employment. The fourth and final way of looking at this is land use as a response to transportation in urban areas. And this is the notion that developing transit hubs and rail transit will lead to clustering of development around stations, both in the form of residential and mixed-use transit-oriented development and concentration of employment at hubs. So here's that graph again I showed at the intro, which shows this four eras. And I would say those four distinctions I mentioned previously are all true to some extent. In other words, it's an interacting system where transportation affects land use and land use in turn affects transportation. Here we can see the four eras. The first, the small little circle in the middle, is the human speed city where people walked or there was horse-drawn trolleys, goods were moved with animals pulling carts, and that meant the city couldn't be very large because you simply couldn't travel very far in a given amount of time. The next stage is the electric streetcar city, where you see expansion, spatial expansion along streetcar lines. Then the growth of private automobiles, which produced even more expansion in between the areas of streetcar lines. And finally, the freeway era, which produced the most spatial expansion. So let's look at those one by one. The first era, the human and animal powered city. So spatial expansion in this era was limited by travel. These cities were growing rapidly as people moved from rural to urban areas and the Industrial Revolution was occurring. And so these cities were packed, very dense, with lots of environmental problems of factories next to houses and lots of crowding. And the reason that was is the city literally couldn't expand because transportation services couldn't get you too far from the center of employment. The second era was the development of the electric streetcars. They improved the speed of travel in cities and opened up suburban expansion. And those streetcars were used as real estate development tools so that areas that were used for agriculture, for example, could be made feasible for residential development by the addition of a streetcar. And the map here is rather small, but this shows it's not just LA is part of our story for streetcars, but this is Detroit, Michigan, and Windsor, Ontario, which also had streetcar systems in this era. Now, the question is, did the streetcars cause the expansion, or did the need to expand cities produce an innovation called electric streetcars? That's a chicken and egg problem that I don't think there's a clear answer to. I think they're co-determined. Here's an image of the Pacific Electric system in Los Angeles, and if you know Los Angeles, this pattern of routes is very similar to the freeways that were developed after these interurban railways were developed. So the original sprawl-inducing effects in Los Angeles were from streetcars rather than the freeway. Now I'd like to direct your attention to this video of Market Street in San Francisco. And this is a period of overlapping eras where you can see all sorts of vehicles on the street, cable cars, horse-drawn vehicles, pedestrians, bicycles. So in a way, this is an ultimate example of multimodal transportation. At the same time, it seems rather chaotic, especially by the modern terms of traffic engineering, which seeks to separate different vehicle types. But you can see a lot of mixing, pedestrians and animals with slow-moving vehicles. You can see that the limited number of private vehicles allowed for all these users to use Market Street. I think you can see the beginnings of the problem when vehicle speed starts to create hazards for pedestrians, cyclists, and so on. And this led to the historic separation of pedestrians, bikes from fast-moving cars. You can see also, even back then, there was competition for the curb, for some parking, and for goods delivery. And obviously, the experience of traveling was influenced by pavement quality, which looked a little bit, cobblestones looked a little bit bumpy. That's an image of where we've come from in our transportation systems. The third area is called the recreational auto era. Before most people used vehicles for work commuting, vehicle ownership went up. And a place like Los Angeles was a leader for this because later development of the city meant there was space to accommodate cars in roads and off-site parking. And especially for early vehicles, the climate was amenable to cars that had less reliability than they do today. In this era, land uses started arranging themselves to accommodate parking. And significantly, also, the use of trucks for industrial uses changed the pattern of industrial uses, where prior they had to be located next to a rail spur to get deliveries and ship finished products. And they began to move to suburban locations because trucks could deliver to a wide variety of locations. Here I'll mention Marty Wack's article and the idea of that there was a conspiracy in the 1950s and 60s to remove street railways and replace that type of transit with rubber-tired buses. And so it's true that auto interests did buy up electric streetcar companies, and often that's said to be the cause for the decline of streetcars. But in fact, ridership had been declining for quite some time, since 1920 with a blip during World War II when there was gas rationing. And people were dissatisfied with rail service. There was a lot of congestion related to competition for road space between street and growing number of cars. And voters chose highway programs over investing in rail in the case of Los Angeles. So the idea that we could have a wonderful rail transit system if only we hadn't taken out the streetcars isn't quite right. The voters made choices for cars, thinking it would liberate them from the limitations of transit and not knowing the consequences in terms of environmental damage or social equity. The fourth era is the freeway transportation era. This is an image of the Arroyo Seco Parkway in Los Angeles. I just like looking at it to see the free flow conditions that rarely exist in the peak hour today. But this provided a rapid increase in mobility, speed, and reach. The engineers that designed it thought they were planning a congestion-free system. And what we didn't know at the time was the idea of induced travel. By providing capacity, travel demand didn't stay fixed. Travel demand grew because people traveled more, traveled longer distances to get to work. And in this era, California was a global leader in freeway construction techniques. And this led to changes in urban form. Traditionally, cities had most of the jobs in the center and residences around them. That's the monocentric city, single center. And the freeway era produced the polycentric city with many centers of employment dispersed across the region. Now let's look at a video of the beginnings of the automobile era. This is a video of Hollywood Boulevard in the 1960s. And what you can see is faster speeds bringing a separation of vehicles and pedestrians, regulation of the vehicle space, regulation of the pedestrian space. You can also notice wide, large, low cars reflecting the architecture of the era. And we can see that parking demand is building and affecting the street and building placement and density. And so This almost idyllic video shows fairly free flow traffic conditions. But today, with intensification of land use, that same street is much more congested. But this was, I guess, an image of the dream of free flow automobile commuting. If everyone didn't have a car, they soon would. And that we could continue to grow cities in this manner. And we found out, of course, that constraints of physical space in the roadway mean that you cannot continue to intensify a city with such a transportation system. So one question is, what's the next era, or what's the era today? And there's many different ideas in play. We have changes in technology and the possibilities of autonomous vehicles. We have transportation network companies providing rides, which might decrease parking demand. We have demographic changes, such as aging baby boomer population. And we have significant issues with gentrification and modal mismatch, where neighborhoods that were highly transit-oriented are gentrifying, and the people that live there and use transit are being displaced to areas that have less transit service. So I think it's an open question in terms of what's coming next, but certainly these bullet points are some of the themes that are going to influence the next era of transportation and land use.